All right, so it is now recording. Everyone can hear me? Just want to double check one last time. You can all hear me, hopefully. All right, so here is how I was intending this to work. This particular, what I want to do this once a week on Wednesdays at the same time. And for those who can't do it every week, that's fine, but we're going to try to record it for people. So for those who are interested in what I have to say, they can listen and hopefully benefit from it in some way. So basically, what the intention we have here is for people to ask questions. You're going to ask questions in a text box. And okay, hold on one second. So for one up for David, it's freezing and kicking him off. David, it's, as I said, it's going to be recorded, so if it still gives you trouble, hopefully you can hear most of it, but if you can't, then it will be available. And if you need to, we can try to do for you, David. We can have you on Skype or Uvu if you have one of those, and you can listen in through that and ask questions through that. But so what I'm intending is for you guys to ask the questions, and I don't have anything prepared as a script. I'm intending this to be a interactive teaching and a study every week. So instead of, you know, how people go to a sermon at a church and, you know, the pastor has his sermon, it's on a subject that he chose already, and the people who attend, they kind of have to listen to whatever he wants to talk about, even if it's something they're not interested in. This way, as we're doing it, it kind of lets people have a little bit more control over the content of the message that's being presented, so that you guys can tell me what you are interested in hearing my thoughts on, and my thoughts will be from the perspective of the Dead Sea Scrolls. I converted to the religion of the Dead Sea Scrolls. The people who wrote the Dead Sea Scrolls, they had a very unique and specific religious outlook on life, and I have tried to restore that religion, to abide by it myself as fully as I possibly can. And so I have a unique position that's you won't really see too much anywhere else, because very few people are trying to restore and copy this religion that the Dead Sea Scrolls teach. So you have a unique outlook on this, and that you guys can, in a way, it's kind of like you have an opportunity to ask an Essene or a Dead Sea Scroll writer, essentially, questions that you've had, like, how do you view something about this or this? And I believe that what I say captures very well what the Essenes closely believe. There may be some differences, of course, but I believe it's very close. So we have one question. Here's the first question from David. And that would be, what can... And I will get to each of the questions I'm able to. So, first I will address the, can you add to the question that David asked is, what can you add to the teaching of the Bible? What are the biggest changes or additional info you can provide? That's a good question. I would say the biggest way to add to the teaching of the Bible and the biggest changes and additional info would really be in what is the Bible itself, because you've got the traditional Bible, which is, as the Jews say, it's 24 books, or, you know, depending how you count them, 39 books. That's the Old Testament. The New Testament, it's 27 books. Together, that's 66 books. Some of the churches have different books, extra books, but so the Ethiopian church, they have 81 books. That's their biggest, that's the biggest church canon out there. What I present is more radical than any other group, and that is, you got the Old Testament and the New Testament, but of the Old and the New, you have like way more writings. Like all in all, it's like about over 200 different writings. And so when you do the math, it comes to about 50 of those writings correspond with the Bible as we know it. 50 of those writings. And then about 150, or maybe, you know, a little bit more. So like about 3/4 of these books. So essentially 75% of all the books that I accept are extra books that people haven't read. But I consider part of the Bible. And that's what you find in the Dead Sea Scrolls. In the Dead Sea Scrolls, you find fragments of tons of books, which are like from all these unknown books, extra books out there. So what that tells us is that from the little we have of the Dead Sea Scrolls, there is so many more stuff out there that these people had and had access to. You can even see that with some of the church fathers. The early church fathers, even though they were rejecting some of the Torah, they had access to some of these extra writings and quoted from them as scripture and believed them to be part of the Bible. So that's probably one of the biggest ways of adding to the teaching of the Bible is adding to the Bible itself. And not just adding extra books, but here's two things, the Septuagint and the Dead Sea Scrolls. Those are versions of the books of the Old Testament. And the books of the Old Testament, there's different manuscripts. The most translations today that you guys are familiar with are translated from the Masoretic text. The Masoretic text has a very specific, narrow tradition where it differs majorly from other copies of the Bible that were preserved by the Christians and by other groups like the Samaritans. When you look at these differences, there's some huge major differences, and so radically different that some of the books of the Bible, when you compare the two, they're like completely different books almost. That's how radically different they are. So I would say that is probably the biggest way to add to the teaching of the Bible, is that I follow all the teachings of these extra books to the best I'm able to do. I try to incorporate all so that it doesn't contradict. Some of it does contradict because there are errors in certain manuscripts and stuff like that, so you have to kind of weed through some of it. But overall, I believe it's very consistent, and it has a lot of extra teachings. So you can imagine if you guys only have 20% of the Bible, 20% what you're reading right now in the Bible, the 66 books, that's only about less than 20% of all of divinely inspired scripture. So imagine what that 80% that you guys are not reading from, how much extra stuff is in that, how much amazing teachings would be in those things that would answer so many questions people have. We wouldn't be having all these debates between people of, is this right, is this right? Because if we had 200 books of scripture, we could appeal to a lot more passages to try to prove certain doctrines are true. And you'd be surprised at what some of these books say. There's some amazing, very deep and profound truths that these books are teaching. But it also teaches some controversial things too, so that you have to be open-minded about what they teach. Just like we ask people who are considering the Bible, the regular Bible, they're from another religion, like atheism, that's not a religion, but, you know, another perspective. Atheists considering converting to the Bible, or Muslims considering accepting the Bible. They have to ask these questions about the Bible and determine whether they can accept it or not. There's some controversial stuff in the Bible that people have a hard time accepting. It's just the same with some of these extra books. So that's the biggest way to add to the teaching of the Bible. And then there's philosophy and logic, which is a very important part to me, for my faith. And that's basically, since there's so many differences in the scriptures and so many errors and bad translations, we have to conclude that we can't just blindly accept what these books are saying. We have to test what the books are saying. We have to research, see which copies are the best, and we have to reason through all this stuff. So it's using your mind, the mind that we were given, to reason through these deep, difficult questions, and using science, logic, and philosophy to try to further figure out what the truth is and correct, if possible, some of the errors in copies of the Bible. So that's my answer for that question. Hopefully that was sufficient for what you were looking for. And the second question was asked by Sean, and that was, can we call it a way of life and not religion? And that was asked in regards to talking about my religion or the religion of the Dead Sea Scrolls. And the question was asked, can we, instead of calling it the religion of the Dead Sea Scrolls, can you call it a way of life? And it's an interesting question because a lot of people have misconceptions about what religion is. And there's a lot of connotations that are associated with many different words. When you look at the definition of religion in its purest, truest form, all it really means is a system of faith that people follow. And everyone who is who believes in something about the supernatural world has a religion in that sense. People use religion in a negative sense, though, usually referring to man-made ideas or, you know, a pagan system that was set up to try to control people. You know, that's not the type of religion that we want, but what we're looking for is something that captures what faith is all about. And that is, as you said, a way of life. But that can also be a religion too, because when you look in the book of James, I think it's chapter, I don't remember what chapter it is. I don't want to cite the wrong chapter, but it's a short book, James, 5 chapters. And in one of those chapters, it says, religion, true religion, is taking care of orphans and widows and the poor, basically. And so we're seeing that James endorses the term religion, but he's using the term religion as a way of life. He's using it to refer to, this is what you do. You love people. That's how a religion is that you put it into practice. It's not just all in your head of beliefs, but it's something you live out and you make it change your life. And the Dead Sea Scrolls talk about the way, and that's what the New Testament says too. That's a similarity they have. Both the scrolls and the New Testament say we should follow the way, and the way is what we really want to follow. According to the New Testament, that's the way is a term, a designation that was used by the true believers to refer to themselves as that's the path of salvation, their way. And some other religions use this too, like Taoism. Taoism, if I understand correctly, Tao refers to the way in another language, and it's a different religion, but it's their similar idea of they believe that's the way, the path they're supposed to walk on. But when you see the way designation used in the New Testament and in the Dead Sea Scrolls, and not in any other Jewish literature, it suggests to us that the New Testament writers came out from the Essene background, their theology, when they were using these Essene terms for themselves. You'll see so much in many other instances that there are so many Essene concepts which are found in no other Jewish group and not really in any other religious group either, but they're found in the New Testament in some of these extra writings. So it's very convincing connection between the apostles and the Essenes of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, the next question is, do you think the Temple Scroll is actually the Book of the Law? And is or how is the Book of the Law covenant applicable to us? Yes, yeah, so if I understand this question correctly, just for people to know, I'm sure my regular listeners know, but for those who are listening to the recording, they might not know this, of the Temple Scroll was a book found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, which claims to be the true law of Moses that Moses actually wrote and that is speaking in the name of Yahuwah directly, like a prophet would speak. And so in the Old Testament, when you see the Josiah, King Josiah, found the Book of the Law, what Book of the Law was this? And the question was, is the Temple Scroll that Book of the Law that Josiah found? And I believe absolutely yes. That is the original Book of the Law that Moses wrote. It's the original Deuteronomy. I've provided evidence in some other teachings to support that position. And so, in my view, the original version, because the Temple Scroll is just a copy of it, an incomplete copy, but an older copy that was found of it was found by Josiah in the temple. According to the Bible, there was a book of the law found, and this book of the law was the law book that this is the same as the Temple Scroll, I believe. And is or how? Oh, and yes, it was the same that was set outside the ark as a witness against us. Now, is the Temple Scroll actually, is the Book of the Law covenant applicable to us? And my view on this is that, first of all, you've got Jeremiah, right? Jeremiah speaks of a new covenant that was to come that is not according to the old. There are some differences, basically. If you read that chapter in Jeremiah, I forget which it is, it speaks of a new covenant contrary to the way the old was. And in the law of Moses, you see a lawgiver, or a prophet like Moses. In other words, a prophet that's a lawgiver. Because not all prophets are like Moses, but a prophet which is a lawgiver would be like Moses. And so that's prophecy of the Messiah would come. He would be a lawgiver. And it says in that passage that we have to obey his commandments. If we don't, we will be held accountable. It will be required of us, it says. And that's in Deuteronomy again. And basically, the Book of the Covenant is a small section of chapters in the Book of Exodus, okay? That would be like about chapters 20 to 23, something around there, maybe 24. I forget if it includes that or not. But basically, that's the basic law that's given to us. It's the Ten Commandments, and then the Ten Commandments are fleshed out, and it's given some extra ideas to support the Ten Commandments. That covenant is applicable to us in the fullest sense, in the sense that what you see in the Book of the Covenant for Exodus, you don't see you don't see curses. If you disobey the law, you get curses. You don't see that. You just see these are the commandments you are to keep. So it's a covenant that doesn't have curses for disobedience. In contrast, the Book of the Law, or the Book of Deuteronomy, has curses. If you break even one part of the law, you are cursed. And there's no atonement provided in the law for willful transgression of the law. If you knowingly transgress any part of the law, it says in the Book of Numbers and in the Book of Deuteronomy that you have no salvation provided for you in the law. So the problem is, most people have broken the law. So that means most people are in condemnation of the law, and the law can't do anything about it. So the law has that standard, a strict standard of this is what's required. The new covenant fills in that hole that the old covenant has, where it provides a way of salvation for us. The Dead Sea Scrolls teach about a new covenant as well. And in that covenant, what do we see the Dead Sea Scroll writers say that covenant is about? They call it the new covenant of repentance through their teacher of righteousness who gave it to them. So the new covenant is about repentance, and that's what the New Testament says it's about as well. It's about atoning for your sins. The Dead Sea Scrolls say there's a Melchizedek document, and it says Melchizedek would come, and he would be the Messiah, and he would atone for the people's sins and provide salvation for them. That's in the Dead Sea Scrolls in the 11th cave. It was called the Melchizedek document by the scholars. And so we're seeing a lot of similar ideas. Like in Hebrews, it talks about the Melchizedek priest, that the Messiah was like Melchizedek. And so very similar ideas from the Dead Sea Scrolls and what the New Testament says. So is the Book of the Law covenant applicable to us? I believe it is, but that it's in the context of a new covenant. So the new covenant kind of overrides certain features of the old covenant, but the old covenant is not like broken or thrown out. It's just kind of like it's kind of like taking a piece of paper and then putting another piece of paper on top of it. The paper, the original paper is still there. It's just being covered by something extra. Okay, and so a lot of the old stuff is repeated in the new, and it's reconfirmed. And the old stuff was the system was all about the animal sacrifices, the priests, you know, the Levitical priesthood, and putting people to death, you know, stoning people, executing them. It is in my belief that when the Messiah came, he saw the horrible corruption that the leaders of the Jews were doing. The sacrificial system was entirely corrupt. They weren't doing it properly, so they basically weren't keeping the law. They were breaking, like, horribly blaspheming by doing all this unlawful stuff in the temple area and profane sacrifices. The priesthood was considered abominable. The Dead Sea Scroll writers tried to break away from that and try to have their own little priest group of separation from the corrupt Jerusalem. And when the Messiah came, he, just like the Essenes, he was attacking their priesthood, their sacrificial system, and saying, this is corrupt, you need to put an end to this. And it is my belief that because he saw how horrible it was, that he decided to put an end to it for a time. The basic idea is, okay, I cannot entrust this any longer to the people. They are corrupting this. They're not going to keep the law. So I'm going to take this stuff away because it's not being kept anyway. I'm going to make it easier for people so they're not being oppressed by people. You know, instead of corrupt judges putting to death innocent people, it's better to have no judges putting to death anyone so that the innocent people are not murdered. So he saved innocent people's lives by taking away the authority of Israel to execute people. And he took away a lot of that profane worship and abomination of the sacrifice system that they were doing, his holy place. You know, the Israel was holy, the promised land, the place where the temple was to be built, that was his special place to be protected and respected, and they weren't respecting it. So his way of respecting the land and respecting the holy place was to make it forbidden to do it there, basically making it so that no one had access there. He used the Gentiles to ban people from being there, and over the years he has passed it from Gentile to Gentile so that they could trample on it and so that the Jews couldn't abominate it like they've been doing. But his plan, his ultimate plan, as we see in the prophets and the Dead Sea Scroll writers believe this, is that the temple system of the Book of the Law covenant would be restored in the time of the Messianic reign. When the Messiah comes and reigns on earth, then the law will be fully kept. But here's the key. It will be kept in the context of the Messiah being chief over all. So he will oversee it all. And he'll make sure that the law is being done right. He won't tolerate such horrible abuse that they were doing. So finally, when the Messiah reigns over us all, in the kingdom, over all the nations, the law will finally be kept as its original intention was. So we're going to be looking forward to that. And there's going to be a transition period. It's my belief that we are transitioning to that point where now the events are unfolding to prepare for that kingdom to come on earth. But first has to come the Antichrist stuff and all, you know, all that stuff of the false peace. And that'll come first. But then finally, when we get all through that, it'll finally be his reign. And the Book of the Law Covenant will be applicable to us, but under the context of the New Covenant. So there will be some differences, but for the most part, it'll still all be applicable, And so in one sense, you could argue that parts of the law were abolished, but not in the sense that Christians are saying. Christians say that some parts of the law were abolished so that they are no longer laws. That's not how the laws were abolished. How they were abolished was being taken away, the ability to keep them was taken away from us. So it's in a sense, you could argue in a sense that they were abolished. But, you know, in the sense that people usually mean, it wasn't abolished. The laws are still there. It's just not being able to be done the proper way right now. But the way will be paved for the proper way to do it in the future. It will happen. And I believe that's what we should all be looking forward to. Now, Sandra asked for a list of books that I consider scripture. And I have a list of those books, but it's a long list. And some of them are not fully, like, it's not entirely certain. In other words, let me give you a little bit of information of how I came to this list. There's an apocryphal book called Second Esdras. A lot of you have probably heard of it, but maybe not all of you. Second Esdras. And in that book, it says that Ezra restored all the scriptures for us, for the people, in his time, because the scriptures had been lost. No one knew where they were anymore. They were hidden. He found them. He restored them. And when he was restoring them, he was told the 24 books, the regular Old Testament, the 24 books, that's to be shared with everybody. But the 70 extra books are to be kept secret and shared only with the worthy who are open to these teachings. And it says in it that those books are the ones that have the true wisdom and amazing teachings that most people are not going to accept. But so that's where the idea of tons of books come from, because according to Second Esdras, there was the 24 plus 70 extra books. So that's 94. That's almost 100 books. And there were books written after Ezra's time, like the Maccabees books, the Wisdom of Sirach. So, you know, and then the Dead Sea Scroll, some of the Dead Sea Scroll writings were written later. So we're seeing at least 100 Old Testament books, according to Second Esdras. And then you have to think, well, you know, Yahuwah likes to repeat himself many times throughout history. So if there's the Old Covenant and a New Covenant, it would make sense for the Old Covenant to have, if they have like 100 writings in the Old, it would make sense for there to be like 100 or so writings in the New Covenant too. And this is exactly what we find. There's a good number of writings in the New Testament era that are available and that still exist. And there's just so much wisdom in these things. But so that's where the books are coming from. But since Ezra doesn't give a list of those books, he simply says there are 24 books plus 70. He doesn't tell us the list of those 70. So when I tried to make that list, I was trying to figure out how to count the books, because it's not always clear. Should I count it as one book or two books? Sometimes it's unclear. But I have a very good approximation of the books, the list of these extra books that are supposed to be. But so just to give you an idea of what some of these books are, I have a list of that I could share with you guys, but to tell you, it's all the books of the Catholic Apocrypha, the standard Apocrypha in the Catholic Bible, and then all the books of the Dead Sea Scrolls, okay? And then there's also books that were preserved by some of the church fathers, fragments in which I also accept. And then there's books in the Old Testament, which we are told once existed. And I accept those as well. Okay. And so to give you an idea of some of what those books are, there's the Enoch books. So there's books by Enoch, the prophet. And then, amazingly, as the Dead Sea Scrolls confirm and as Jubilee says, there's also books by Lamech, Noah's father. There's books by Noah himself, by Abraham, by Jacob, by his 12 sons. They all wrote their own words as their deathbed, their testaments. And then the priests, the line of Levi, we have writings preserved from them. We have Levi's son, he wrote words for us, and some of it was prophetic, and that was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. We also have Levi's grandson, who was the father of Moses and Aaron, and he has words for us too. So we've got some of that. We've got the Book of Jubilees, which was written by Moses, and we have another one or two books written by Moses, which there are some fragments of, but they're lost. Now the full version is lost. But it was a testament, the final words of Moses, but it was also writing down visions. He had extra visions, extra secrets, extra things he wanted people to know. There was some amazing stuff in this extra Moses book. And Jude the Apostle in the New Testament quotes from this extra Moses book and quotes from it as an authoritative source. Just like he quotes from the Book of Enoch as an authoritative source. You see that in Jude. You see he quotes from Enoch, the prophet, and then gives the quotation from the Book of Enoch. And he says that's true prophecy. And then from this extra Moses book, he gives the prophecy of an event that happened about Michael, the archangel, debating with Satan over Moses' dead body. That occurs only in this lost Apocrypha book. So Jude is clearly endorsing that story. So that's an amazing book right there. Then there's an extra book about Job. You know, the Book of Job? Well, there's a little more information if you wanted to learn more about Job's story. He wrote more about his life. So there's a book out there that's about his life. You know, all the prophets, the 12 minor prophets, like Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, you know, all those, the 12. There's evidence, some of those books still exist, but most of them don't, but they exist in fragmentary form. But most of those books by those minor prophets, most of those prophets wrote extra books. Like, they wrote another book of prophecy. Like, have you ever wondered, like, in the Book of Jonah? There's, like, no prophecy in the Book of Jonah. That's, like, a really strange book. Like, it does a narrative, but there's, like, almost no prophecy in that book. Well, according to the evidence that's out there, there's actually other prophecies that Jonah did and were written down. That book is lost to us, but we have some of those prophecies preserved in a shorthand. And there was a prophecy of Zephaniah. Zephaniah died, and he had a vision and out-of-body experience where he saw the place of the dead, and Zephaniah wrote this down. We have fragments of this book. The church fathers had the full book, but we don't have that anymore. But just the fragments we have of it. But so we have an idea of this Zephaniah book. There was a Habakkuk book that told more information about his life, told stories about Daniel. We have a couple excerpts from that book. So we have, you know, extra books from these prophets that were once existing too. And then we have an extra Isaiah book that does exist in full, preserved by the Ethiopian church. The Ethiopians preserved for us Enoch and Jubilees, which the Dead Sea Scrolls preserved. So we can trust, well, if they preserve these books, then we can also trust their preservation of this Isaiah book too. And in this Isaiah book, there's some amazing stuff. Prophecies about the Messiah, prophecies about the nature of Yahuwah. Who is God? What is he like? He talks about the Holy Spirit, about the Father, and how it relates to each other. And Isaiah ends up being killed in that book by Manasseh. He becomes a martyr. And it's an amazing book. And it exists in full. So that's one that I accept. And there is a Ezekiel book. There are fragments, a lot of fragments of that, from the Dead Sea Scrolls. The book that I mentioned was the Isaiah book. It's Apocryphon of Isaiah. It's called the Martyrdom and Ascension of Isaiah. But for the Ezekiel book, scholars call it the Apocryphon of Ezekiel, and that's found in the Dead Sea Scrolls. And there's also fragments of it found by church fathers quoting it, and then in some Greek fragments. So we have Ezekiel having an extra book of prophecy. It follows along the book of Ezekiel. It follows along many ways. Like, it talks, you know, the vision of the dry bones. It prophesies of that. It records that vision again, but gives more detail about it. And that book of of Ezekiel was quoted by some ancient writers, like the Epistle of Barnabas, it quotes it. So they had access to this book still. So that's very amazing. And Jeremiah, there's so many extra books of Jeremiah, it's crazy. And it's all focusing around Baruch. Baruch was the scribe of Jeremiah. And Baruch would write some extra things that Jeremiah told him to write down. And we have copies of some of that. And there's some extra extra writings that prophecies of Jeremiah. And then the Dead Sea Scrolls has fragments of an extra Jeremiah book, which tells us that there's a whole book of Jeremiah that we're missing, which once existed. And let's see here. And then we've got extra Proverbs by Solomon. And we've got many more Psalms from David. So many more. Like, we only had like about 150 in the Bible. Well, would you believe that there was once over 4,000 Psalms of David? Songs and Psalms. That's what the Dead Sea Scrolls says, and there's some evidence to support that. The Dead Sea Scrolls have a lot of extra stuff, but most of those songs were lost. The Bible tells us that Solomon wrote 1,005 songs. That's in 1 Kings. But we only have one song of Solomon's in the Bible. We have about 60 Psalms, songs by Solomon, the Odes of Solomon, and the Psalms of Solomon. Those exist, but there's only about 60 of those. But imagine, we only have one of Solomon's songs, and yet the Bible tells us he did 1,005. So we're 1,000 of them are gone. It's the same thing with David. We've got several hundred of his writings, of his Psalms, but then the vast majority of his Psalms are vanished. They were lost. And as I said, there's the Catholic Apocrypha, so that's Tobit, Judith, Wisdom of Solomon, the Wisdom of Sirach, there's the Maccabees books, and you've got Second Esdras, that's the prophecy from Ezra, the prophet, and there's another book similar to Esther, which was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, which has a very similar story in the same basic time period. It's like called the Patireza and Begazro, they call it. There's so many, there's a huge amount of writings. I have the full list of what I've found, so I can share that with you all who are interested. But that's for the Old Testament stuff. And then there's the New Testament stuff. So you wonder, that seems strange that, you know, most of the New Testament is Paul. What about all the apostles? What did they write? Why didn't the 12 apostles write other stuff? Well, they did write other stuff. And you ask, there's a new covenant, and yet we're not told anywhere in the New Testament where the terms of the new covenant are. What are the laws and requirements of the new covenant that we have to follow? They're not in the Bible. But they are in the Bible of the Ethiopian Orthodox Church. And they accept it as scripture. It's part of their New Testament. And it gives the laws fully of what they are to do for part of the new covenant. And there's some amazing stuff in these writings. So the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, I trust as the closest group to the true faith. They'd have the closest group to the Dead Sea Scrolls. The Ethiopian Orthodox Church does many things that Messianics do. They believe in the food laws. They believe in the uncleanness laws. And they have so many of these extra books that are scripture. And their priest laws that they're doing are very similar to laws in the Old Testament. They believe they have the Ark of the Covenant. You know, that's a very Old Testament type of thinking. The other Christian groups don't care about the Ark of the Covenant. They think that's the old stuff. Ark of the Covenant, who cares? Yeah, the Ethiopians, they're preserving it with the full conviction that the law tells us we have to protect and honor the Ark of the Covenant. We got to do this. And that's what they try to do in obedience to the law. So the Ethiopian Orthodox Church, really close. If there's any group, I would say just copy everything they do. I wouldn't, you know, I don't say that. I don't say just copy everything they do. But if I had to, I'd tell you, do what the Ethiopian Orthodox Church does. Believe their books. Follow what those books say. They got something close. So their books of the New Testament, like we have 27 books in the regular Bible. The Ethiopian Orthodox has 35 books in their New Testament. And there's so much extra stuff in there. It's like amazing, really amazing stuff. Your mind would be blown. What's in there? Like it, there's so much stuff that just like would destroy most of what people believe, but it wouldn't destroy it in a bad sense of like, okay, now our whole faith is demolished, but now it shows you here's the true faith. It destroys the false ideas that people have and ends the debates, if you accept these books as true anyways. But so what we're told in the New Testament is that after he rose from the dead, for 40 days he was with his apostles and was teaching them secrets and was teaching them about the new covenant. What was he being taught during those 40 days? Well, in the what do we see in the Old Testament? Moses was on the mountain for 40 days and received the law, you know, during those 40 days. So it's the same thing of the Messiah was giving the law during those 40 days of the new law. And the apostles wrote it down, and the Ethiopian church preserved it for us. And so it's really amazing that they did that. And so, you just ask the question of, did so-and-so apostle have a book? Right away, I can tell you, yeah, he did. No matter which apostle you tell me, I can tell you, yes, there was. But some of those are missing. But there's also extra books about the acts of each of the apostles. Most of them got destroyed by the Catholic Church because there was some stuff in that the people didn't like. But there was acts about extra things that the apostle Paul did. What was his story? What preachings did he do to the people, and what miracles did he do? That was in the Acts of Paul. Acts of Peter, Acts of John, Acts of Andrew, and Acts of Thomas. Those were the main acts. There were other acts too, but those were the main ones, and most of those were destroyed except for fragments here and there. But Thomas, Acts of Thomas was preserved fully for us. But so you wonder, what did these apostles do? All we have is the Acts of the Apostles, and it doesn't tell us that much. It only focuses mostly on, you know, Peter a little bit, and then Paul. Well, these other Acts books focus on, like, you know, everyone else and what they did, and it really fills in the holes and so we've got that. We've got extra revelations the apostles had, and then we have writings of some of the disciples of the apostles. We've got writings from Ignatius. We've got writings from Clement. We've got writings from Dionysius, the Areopagite. So all in all, there's just so much out there that people have no clue about, but which if people started reading these books, they would start getting much wiser. And I'm fully convinced if we follow these books, it'll change our life. And this is the truth, I believe. So if we follow these books, then we will find the path of salvation, but we have to seek it with all our heart, because otherwise we're not going to find it. That's kind of a long answer to that question, and I can give the list for people, for those who are interested in the list of books that I have found. So let me see the other questions here. Okay, so there's a question. The one question was, how can you, as a Qumran Essene, discuss these matters with us when you are prohibited by the rule to speak of these things with the perverse? And then someone else asked, who decides who is the perverse? And then Jackson says, the rule, anyone outside the cult was perverse. So let me clarify a little bit, because I do think there is a misunderstanding there, and that is, I don't think they viewed everyone outside of the cult as, how do I put it? There's different terms that people use, like the scrolls use to refer to people. And extra writings do this too. They make distinctions between people. There's the ignorant, you know, so there's ignorant who are, but they're sincere. They're trying to find the truth, but they're ignorant. But they're looking for the truth. They just don't have it yet. Then there's the people who are willfully ignorant, you know, they're lazy, they don't really care much, and then there's people who also are arrogant. And these are the ones we want to watch out for, the arrogant ones. Those who are arrogant, we really don't want to cast our pearls before swine, okay? So if people are going to just be, like, full of, like, hateful speech and wanting to blaspheme and just, like, you know, they're just interested in a debate and trying to argue with you, you should really just avoid those people and not talk to them. Don't share these things with them, because they're just going to, what they're going to do is they're going to, you know, for a fact, because of how they are, you know that they're going to mock what you're saying. They're not going to accept it. And they are going to blaspheme it. And they're just going to, they're going to do so much hateful stuff. And the scriptures tell us, the scriptures condemn us for causing his name to be blasphemed. If we cause his name to be more blasphemed than otherwise is needed, he's angry with us who are preaching to the people. So we have an obligation to protect his words and sacred things. And for those who aren't open to what the truth is, we're not supposed to share all these things with them. And there are certain doctrines and teachings out there which are only supposed to be shared with those who are converted fully to the group. And each you get converted, and then there's different levels of teaching. And so basically, the more studying you do, the more you're learning and accepting, the more you can learn and the more you can accept. So there's like, so you know, 200 or so books out there. Well, do you want to learn what they say? Well, then start going through the process of how you're supposed to study and learn these things. You start at the basics, you learn the basic stuff. And then once you pass those things, then you're moving on to the next level of teaching. And so the full teachings are for those who are the most trustworthy and who have shown that they are really serious about this and that they really want to, this is what they believe. So it's all about protecting the words. And so I can do something like this, teaching people, because I know that all of you guys are not, you're not arrogant. You're not, you guys really want truth and you're open to things and you respect what I have to say. You don't chastise me. You don't ridicule or belittle me. So you have that openness to what I have to say. But so I don't think, some people misunderstand. I think people misunderstand that the Essenes couldn't teach anyone. But I don't think that's the case, because, you know, we see, according to Josephus, the Essenes went out and tried to get as many people to come in as possible. It was orphans and people who were poor. They tried to bring people in. So they were teaching and preaching the truth to people. It just, they were selective who they chose. Like it says in the New Testament, you go to a place, and if they reject you, then dust off your shoulders, wipe off your feet, move on to the next place. You don't keep going there and casting the truth to people who aren't open to it. It's like knocking on a door, and then someone says, go away, I don't want to talk to you. And they close the door, and you're still like knocking on it. Hello, you know, they don't want to talk to you, move on, because they're not interested in what you have to say. That I guess that would be my answer. I hope that suffices. Now, let's see here. And then there was a question asked. Can you please give us a brief history of the Temple Scroll when it was found and lost around 5 times? Basically, according to these extra scriptures, what we're told is an interesting history of how the Temple Scroll, or the Book of the Law, was lost and found many different times. So history repeating itself. It starts off very early, where during the period of the Judges, it's lost. No one knows about its existence, because no one's looking at the Ark of the Covenant. People are falling away during the Judges' periods. There's a lot of apostasy. Everyone's doing what they want to in their own eyes, as the Book of Judges says. So everyone's looking at it, and then they're not considering what the law says, because they're not even opening the Ark to read it. They're not even consulting the Ark. Then in the time of David found during his life, David, was it in David's lifetime, or was it, I think it was in Saul's, actually, before him, the Ark of the Covenant, maybe it was even before Saul, the Ark of the Covenant was stolen by the Philistines, okay? It was stolen because the Israelites disobeyed Yahuwah and were very reckless and went into war without permission. So Yahuwah decided to punish them by letting the Philistines take the Ark of the Covenant. The Ark of the Covenant was killing lots of Philistines, and there was lots of plagues for the Philistines, so they were able to send it back to Israel. But it stayed at people's houses here and there. It was staying, you know, it wasn't where it was supposed to be. Finally, David brought it back near the end of his reign. It says in the scriptures of the Old Testament, he was bringing the Ark of the Covenant back. So what do you think happened? Well, when the Ark of the Covenant was back, there was the law. He read it and found out about its fuller laws that they didn't realize. And then he changed his life and repented of his ways. And that's when he decided to tell his son Solomon to build a temple. Because it says in Chronicles that David was given a law for the temple from Yahuwah in a writing. And that David used this writing to teach Solomon of how to build a temple. He gave him a blueprint. And that was the blueprint Solomon used to build a temple. So according to the Dead Sea Scrolls, it was lost until David and Zadok, the priest Zadok, the high priest, he was the one who found the law and revealed it and published it, and David heard it, and that's how the law was found then. Then it got lost again, and then it was found in the time of Josiah. The Old Testament says that Josiah found this book of the law in the temple, or his priests found it. And so when he read it, or when he heard it read to him, he was weeping and realizing, wow, so much of the law we were held by and condemned for. Now let us return to the law. And so there was that restoration. Then all the scriptures were lost in the time when Nebuchadnezzar came and he destroyed the temple. He was destroying Jerusalem and send the Israelites into exile. Well, you know, and probably the copies of the scripture were destroyed. You know, there probably weren't too many copies of the scripture. You know, the prophets were still writing them, and not all the Israelites accepted the prophets. Most of the prophets were killed. So most of the Israelites didn't really treasure the books of the prophets enough to continue copying it. So most of the prophets, no one was reading. There was probably only one or two copies. And then they got destroyed. Or according to these apocryphal books, they were placed in a vase and they were partially burned. Like, you know, the scrolls, they are damaged. The scrolls were placed in a vase by someone last minute, and they were damaged. Ezra received the power from Yahuwah to read those scrolls, to know where they are, to find the scrolls, and then to restore the scrolls perfectly, word for word, letter for letter. He restored them all. He had five people with him who were scribes, and they were writing out the law. It took 40 days to write the entire scriptures out. 94 books were written. So that was the restoration of the temple scroll then. Then it was also lost again during the time of the Greek. The Greek Empire was overseeing Israel and was destroying anyone who had copies of the law was to be killed, and those copies were to be burned and destroyed. So you can imagine a lot of the scriptures were being lost at that time. According to the Maccabees books, Judah Maccabee, he was the one who, he was the leader of the Maccabees, and he made a call to everyone, and he said, okay, everyone, get those scriptures, as many as you can find, collect them all, so that we can have a library of his word. Restore the scriptures. We need to restore the covenant. We need to restore and purify the temple. So he did that. They restored the temple, and he gathered all the lost books that were scattered throughout Israel. Anyone who had them, anywhere they could find them, gathered them together, and then published them, shared them with the people who wanted access to them. So that was the next one. And then finally, they got lost again with the second destruction of the temple. The Israelites were scattered. You know, the copies of scripture weren't copied anymore because no one knew Hebrew much anymore. They didn't know how to copy them or read them, translate them. So much was lost at this time. The temple scroll has been found once again. Another time. It's been found again in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Finally, again. And many of these lost books were found, but not fully. So here's what's either going to happen. We need to wait for some more of these Dead Sea Scrolls to be found, and hopefully they will. Or when the Messiah comes back, he's going to reveal where all the other scrolls are, and then we'll find them, and then we'll have the full scriptures, all scriptures, and he'll tell us which ones are false. Like, if some of the books I believe are false, he'll tell us, oh, no, that's not true, that's garbage. That someone invented that, so he'll be able to tell us with 100%, we'll have 100% certainty what his full scripture is when the Messiah comes back. But a lot of the scriptures have been found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, sort of a taste of what is out there, what once was, and so many books have been being found by different libraries and churches and different finds. It's amazing what's being restored in these final times. In the last several centuries, so many writings have been restored. But this was all prophesied of. There are books that prophesied that the Apocrypha and all these extra books would be lost. And then there's books which said that these books will be restored in the last days. And it's happening as they said it would happen. It's just amazing. So that's a sufficient answer for the history of the temple scroll, how it was lost and discovered, according to history and according to what these scriptures say. Some of the laws, we're not going to be held accountable to because we don't have access to them. But some of the laws we will be held accountable to, even though we don't have access to the full original law. And why? Because we have natural law within us, and we also have other books which preserve some of those lost ideas, like the New Testament extra books and the Old Testament and some of those extra books. So we have a lot of resources to use to know much of his laws for his people. We have a Dead Sea Scrolls, so there's a lot we're accountable for, even though we don't have the full thing preserved. We have a good chunk of it preserved, so we're going to be held to a high standard, much higher than the church generations in the medieval ages who didn't have access to a lot of these extra books. But now, Yahuwah wants the scrolls to be restored. He wants them to be used to restore his faith. And so, because he wants that, he's now holding us to that higher standard. The scrolls have been found. They're there. So we don't have excuse anymore. Now we got to start studying these writings. Otherwise, we're going to be heaping on condemnation for willful ignorance on our part by not looking at what these writings say. So I need to read and see some of these other questions, if there's any others. Hold on. It got messed up. Did you guys hear most of what I said? Hopefully it wasn't cutting out most of the time. But let's see here. Let me see. And there are books about Mary, and there are, there's a letter from the Messiah that we have. There's some other books about these people. There's a question, should we discredit all Gnostic texts? Not all of them, but many of them we should discredit because they just are completely against the Bible when you read their contents. But if you can read a Gnostic text, and if the Gnostic text doesn't say too much that, that really clearly contradicts the scriptures, I would endorse that Gnostic text, provided that it is claiming to be written by a apostle or one of the people. So there's a lot of so-called Gnostic writings which are attributed to the apostles and their disciples, like the Gospel of Thomas, teachings of Silvanus. A lot of these I would say are valid because they have a lot of good teaching in them, and I don't see them as Gnostic. I see them as corresponding with the other scriptures. Let me see here. Is there an Ethiopian Orthodox Bible? there's an Ethiopian Orthodox Bible in Ethiopian or in Amharic. It's not translated into English. And even in that, not all the books are in the Ethiopian Bible. Basically, these extra books of the New Testament of the Ethiopian Bible that I mentioned, they're not even allowed to be shared by most of the Ethiopian church, the members. Most of their members are not allowed to read it. The only ones who are allowed to read it are the priests, so they're the ones who have access to it, and then the priests are able to teach the people from what they know, but they don't read it in the church services, and they don't show them, they don't have them read these books. So it's a select few of the Ethiopian church are reading these extra New Testament books, and I'll hopefully do videos on this on these things in the future. Like, as someone asked, of doing videos about some of these extra books, I should hopefully do that in the future. Let's see. Okay. I'm just seeing, Okay, so the question, how can we trust, the question is, how can we trust the translation from the Ethiopian to the English? And it's the same question we kind of can ask. How can we trust the translation from the Hebrew to the English, from the Greek to the English? You know, all these questions of how can we trust a translation? And there's several things about this, is that the translators, first of all, they understand the language, but not perfectly, okay? So they're missing a lot of depth to some of these languages, but so they understand somewhat these languages. And secondly, they are trying to accurately translate. So they're trying. I don't believe translators are intentionally distorting it, okay? So there's that. And then what you really want to do is to have a translation which the translator tells you what he did. Like, for instance, R.H. Charles, that's one that's you. Many of the Ethiopian writings, that's his translation. Well, the problem is, sometimes R.H. Charles does some iffy stuff that is questionable. He changes things in the Ethiopian text and puts that as part of his translation. Most people are now using a version of his book which does not have his footnotes. So people don't know about this because they're not reading the footnotes. So that makes some of the translation a little bit dangerous when you do that. But when you have his footnotes, then you can see, okay, I see what he was changing. He tells us what he's changing, why he changed it sometimes. So you can see kind of how he translated it. And you should always read, when you have a translation, try to make sure that they have an explanation of how they did the translation, their philosophy, their methodology for translating. You'll see that in most major translations, there's a beginning, a preface, and they will tell you, this is how we translated it, and this is the process we went through. You know, we try to be faithful, you know, we didn't do it perfectly, they'll say. But I would say that the translations, you should trust the basic ideas, but not the words. The words being used are very often, like, deceptive, okay? So you don't want to necessarily take something too literally unless you have a good understanding of the possible Hebrew base, because there's so many ways it can be changed in translation, just subtle changes that can make huge differences in interpretation. So it really helps to have a small basic understanding of the depth of Hebrew and how a word in Hebrew can have many different meanings, so that when you read something, like, for instance, whenever I see in a book the word sin, I immediately know in my mind, oh yeah, that word sin in Hebrew doesn't always mean sin. Sometimes it can mean something else. So if I see a passage which talks about sin but says something really bizarre that sounds completely false, I question that translation and say, there's something I think the translation they must have translated this badly because it doesn't make sense what they're saying. So always go to is what the translation is saying, like, matching to other texts? If it's not, you might want to start questioning some of what it's saying. But really try to learn the Hebrew base, and then once you learn more about Hebrew, when you see in any other language, like English, Greek, Latin, whenever you see words in those languages, you can know, oh yeah, when they have that English word, it usually means it's the Hebrew this. Oh yeah, when you see this Greek word, it's usually this Hebrew word. So you make associations and connections so that now I'm at a point where I can read something, and if I see something that sounds iffy, I have a working Hebrew mindset of what it might possibly be differently if it was translated slightly differently. So there's a lot of things like that. The Ethiopian translation, from my experience, is pretty good, pretty reliable. I think you can trust it very well. The Ethiopians did, I think, a very good job with most of the books that they preserved for us, and then the translators themselves were very academic, very scholarly. Everyone looks up to their translations as very good work. You know, again, not perfect. There are some flaws in some of these translations, but you just got to accept what you're able to accept at the time. And here's the key. Look at what these scriptures are saying, and if one book says something iffy, compare it to other books. And so the more books you have that you can use to support a teaching, the more likely it's to be true. It's a difficult process sometimes to weed out what's true and what's not, but if you stick with it and learn the ins and out of it, then it becomes much easier and you can identify things and have much better discernment about what's true and what's false. And then there's a question, do I know about the other Bible edited by Willis Barnstone? The title, The Other Bible, sounds familiar. I don't have a clear picture of it in my mind, but usually, let me just tell you, when people do translations like that, a good amount of the time is people copying and pasting from other people's translations. So you want to watch out for that, because a lot of people they put the books together and they charge a lot of money for it, when really it's someone else's work and it's freely available online. So why would you pay a lot of money for something that's already available and it's someone else's work? You can get it a lot cheaper. So, you know, it's I would be very careful of a lot of these other, you know, like books published by regular people, because most of the people that are doing these works are using R.H. Charles' version and then changing certain things, or they're using the standard translation that most people use and then tinker with it a little bit by changing the names of, like, you know, that they'll make it a little bit more Hebraic. They'll say Yahuwah instead of Lord. But otherwise, it's basically copying someone else's translation. So most people don't have these credentials to say that these translations they're doing are really their translations. It's just so I'd be very cautious of books like that. But any particular book, like what you just showed me, I'd have to look at that later, see if it's good or not, and then I can give you my opinion on it. Just by reading the preview, what's in it, and then, you know, reviews on it, you can get a good idea if it's a good one or not. Let's see. Yeah, so which Gnostic texts, was the question, which ones are good and which ones are bad? The ones that are good that I've found, there's a Gospel of Thomas, the Gospel of Mary, teachings of Silvanus, there's a dialogue of the Savior, I think it's called. I mean, there's a list I have, so I can give a list. It's not too many. There's a Book of Thomas, the Contender. The Gospel of Philip, almost, but there's some things in there that are a little iffy. So I'd be a little bit iffy on the Gospel of Philip. But so there's a good number. I have the list, but yeah, the Gospel of Mary, it's Mary Magdalene. And it's fragmentary. It's not fully preserved. So let me see if there was one other question that I skipped because I didn't know what to say for that for a second, but let me find it. It's the one about Moses. They were saying, by reading today's Torah, I wonder why Moses is referred to as a prophet. Maybe in his other books, it's clearer that he is a prophet. For instance, there is a huge section, the Testament of Moses, which is preserved, which shows prophecies that he's giving to Joshua. And there's also some prophecies preserved of other things that Moses saw. I'm going to switch a tab for a second. Hopefully the cam will still be here. I'm going to read from something to show you. This is a summary of what Moses saw. Okay? And if you guys want, I can read through some of these. Do you guys want me to read some of these Moses, what's preserved of Moses, some of the prophecies that he might have seen? It's to give you an idea of what Moses might have. I'm very confident that these sources are, in general, reliable. There's a couple things about it that are a little uncertain, but for the most part, I endorse what I find in these things. So let me pull that up for you guys. Let's see here. Okay, so can you guys still hear me? Making sure you guys can still hear me. Let's see here. Okay, good. Still hear me? So here's what it's gonna show you. This is from a book called Second Baruch. It's the Syriac Apocalypse of Baruch. The Baruch, again, was the scribe of Moses. Jeremiah. And this is from chapter 59. And this is what it says. This is basically a summary of some of the things that Moses was shown. So it says, "And the bright fourth waters which thou hast seen are the advent of Moses and Aaron and Miriam and Joshua the son of Nun and Caleb and all of all those like them. For at that time the lamp of the eternal law shone on all those who sat in darkness, which announced to them that believe the promise of their reward, and to them that deny the torment of fire which is reserved for them. But also the heavens at that time were shaken from their place, and those who were under the throne of the Mighty One were perturbed when he was taking Moses unto himself. For he showed him many admonitions, together with the principles of the law and the consummation of the times, as also to thee, and likewise the pattern of Zion on it and its measures, in the pattern of which the sanctuary of the present time was to be made. But then also he showed to him the measures of the fire, also the depths of the abyss, and the weight of the winds, and the numbers of the drops of rain, and the suppression of anger, and the multitude of long-suffering, and the truth of judgment, and the root of wisdom, and the riches of understanding, and the fount of knowledge, and the height of the air, and the greatness of paradise, and the consummation of the ages, and the beginning of the day of judgment, and the number of the offerings, and the earths which have not yet come, and the mouth of Gehenna, and the station of vengeance, and the place of faith, and the region of hope, and the likeness of future torment, and the multitude of innumerable angels, and the flaming hosts, and the splendor of the lightnings, and the voice of the thunders, and the orders of the chiefs of the angels, and the treasuries of light, and the changes of the times, and the investigations of the law. These are the bright fourth waters which thou hast seen." But so that quotation basically tells us that Moses was shown all those things. That's pretty crazy, you know, because most of that stuff is not in the writings of Moses, you know. And so some of that stuff is confirmed in some of these fragments that I've found that the rabbis preserved for us in some of their midrashs. Sometimes the rabbis preserved fragments of truth, some of the Apocrypha sometimes, in their midrashes. And so this is one that I found, and let me pull up that page. I'm going to read some of these prophecies for you guys. This is from the Legends of the Jews. You'll see in the Legends of the Jews, there's some good stuff in there, and there's some bad stuff. The guy who made it, compiled it, he used all different kinds of sources that the Jews had. Good ones, bad ones, horrible ones, you know, put it all together. So you have to be really careful when you're reading through what he compiled together. But some of the stuff that he compiled for Moses matches pretty well what was described in that prophecy that I just read from. So let me find the... So... So here's something from what Moses was shown. Hold on 1 second. This is when Moses was on the mountain of the burning bush, okay? And it says, and again, as I said, it's corrupted sometimes by some of what the rabbis put in. But overall, I trust what these are saying to be close summary of what was in this lost book, okay? It says, "The vision of the burning bush appeared to Moses alone. The other shepherds with him saw nothing of it. He took 5 steps in the direction of the bush to view it at close range, and when God beheld the countenance of Moses distorted by grief, anxiety over Israel's suffering, he spake, 'This one is worthy of the office of pasturing my people.'" Moses was still a novice in prophecy, therefore God said to himself, "If I reveal myself to him in loud tones, I shall alarm him. But if I reveal myself with a subdued voice, he will hold prophecy in low esteem." Whereupon he addressed him in his father Amram's voice. That's probably not true, but so that's what it says there, okay? Moses was overjoyed to hear his father speak, for it gave him the assurance that he was still alive. The voice called his name twice, and he answered, "Here am I. What is my father's wish?" God replied, saying, "I am not thy father." Well, you know, but maybe it's true, so I could be wrong in dismissing that, but it says, God replied, saying, "I am not thy father, I but desired to refrain from terrifying thee, therefore I spoke with thy father's voice. I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." These words rejoiced Moses greatly, for not only was his father Amram's name pronounced in the same breath with the names of the three patriarchs, but it came before theirs as though he ranked higher than they. Moses said not a word. In silent reverence before the divine vision, he covered his face, and when God disclosed the mission with which he charged him of bringing the Israelites forth from the land of Egypt, he answered with humility, "Who am I that I should go unto Pharaoh and bring forth the children of Israel out of Egypt?" Thereupon spake God, "Moses, thou art meek, and I will reward thee for thy modesty. I will deliver the whole of Egypt into thine hand, and besides, I will let thee ascend unto the throne of my glory, and look upon all the angels of the heavens." Hereupon God commanded Metatron, the angel of the face, or the angel of the presence, to conduct Moses to the celestial regions amid the sound of music and song, and he commanded him furthermore to summon 30,000 angels to serve as his bodyguard, 15,000 to right of him, and 15,000 to left of him. In abject terror, Moses asked Metatron, "Who art thou?" And the angel replied, "I am Enoch, the son of Jared, thy ancestor, and God has charged me to accompany thee to his throne." But Moses demurred, saying, "I am but flesh and blood, and I cannot look upon the countenance of an angel." Whereupon Metatron changed Moses' flesh into torches of fire, his eyes into Merkabah wheels, his strength into an angel's, and his tongue into a flame, and he took him to heaven with a retinue of 30,000 angels, one half moving to right of them, and one half to left of them. In the first heaven, Moses saw streams upon streams of water, and he observed that the whole heaven consisted of windows, at each of which angels were stationed. Metatron named and pointed out all the windows of heaven to him, the window of prayer and the window of supplication, of weeping and of joy, plenitude and starvation, wealth and poverty, War and peace, conception and birth, showers and soft rains, sin and repentance, life and death, pestilence and healing, sickness and health, and many windows more. In the second heaven, Moses saw the angel Nuriel standing 300 parasangs high, with his retinue of 50 myriads of angels, all fashioned out of water and fire, and all keeping their face turned toward the Shekinah while they sang a song of praise to God. Metatron explained to Moses that these were the angels set over the clouds, the winds, and the rains, who return speedily, as soon as they have executed the will of their Creator, to their station in the second of the heavens, there to proclaim the praise of God. In the third heaven, Moses saw an angel so tall it would take a human being 500 years to climb to his height. He had 70,000 heads. So some of this stuff I'm not sure about, you know, some of these details, but who knows, maybe. Each head having as many mouths, each mouth as many tongues, and each tongue as many sayings. And he, together with his suite of 70,000 myriads of angels, made of white fire, praised and extolled the Lord. So I think some of that is definitely true. But the what they were saying, 70,000 heads, some of that stuff, I'm not completely sure about that. But so then, these, said Metatron to Moses, are called Eberlim, and they are appointed over the grass, the trees, the fruits, and the grain. But as soon as they have done the will of their Creator, they return to the place assigned to them and praise God. In the fourth heaven, Moses saw a temple, the pillars thereof made of red fire, the staves of green fire, the thresholds of white fire, the boards and clasps of flaming fire, the gates of carbuncles, and the pinnacles of rubies. Angels were entering the temple and giving praise to God there. In response to a question from Moses, Metatron told him that they presided over the earth, the sun, the moon, the stars, and the other celestial bodies, and all of them intone songs before God. In this heaven, Moses noticed also the two great planets, Venus and Mars, each as large as the whole earth, and concerning these he asked what unto what purpose they had been created. Metatron explained thereupon that Venus lies upon the sun to cool him off in summer. So as I said, some of this might not be true. Else he would scorch the earth, and Mars lies upon the moon to impart warmth to her, lest she freeze the earth. But as I said, the guy compiled this using different sources, so he might have supplemented what from this text, he might have supplemented some other ideas. And then, arrived in the fifth heaven, Moses saw hosts of angels whose nether parts were of snow and their upper parts of fire, and yet the snow did not melt, nor was the fire extinguished, for God had established perfect harmony between the two elements. These angels, called Eshim, have had nothing to do since the day of their creation but praise and extol the Lord. In the sixth of the heavens were millions and myriads of angels praising God, and they were called Irene and Kedashim, watchers and holy ones. And their chief was made of hail, and he was so tall it would take 500 years to walk a distance equal to his height. In the last heaven, Moses saw two angels, each 500 parasangs in height, forged out of chains of black fire and red fire. The angels Aph, anger, and Hema, wrath, whom God created at the beginning of the world to execute his will. Moses was disquieted when he looked upon them, but Metatron embraced him and said, Moses, Moses, thou favorite of God, fear not and be not terrified. And Moses became calm. There was another angel in the seventh heaven, different in appearance from all the others, and of frightful mien. His height was so great it would have taken 500 years to cover a distance equal to it, and from the crown of his head to the soles of his feet. He was studded with glaring eyes, at the sight of which the beholder fell prostrate in awe. This one said, Metatron, addressing Moses. This one, said Metatron, addressing Moses, is Semael, who takes away from man. Whither goes he now? Asked Moses. And Metatron replied, to fetch the soul of Job the pious. Thereupon Moses prayed to God in these words, O may it be thy will, my God and the God of my fathers, not to let me fall into the hands of this angel. And let me just finish up this thing about the heaven not too much longer. Here in the highest heaven, he also saw the seraphim with their six wings. With two they cover their face, and they gaze not upon the Shekinah, and with two their feet, which being like a calf's feet, they hide to keep secret Israel's transgression of the golden calf. With the third pair of wings they fly and do the service of the Lord, all the while exclaiming, "Holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, the whole earth is full of his glory." The wings of these angels are of prodigious size. It would take a man 500 years to traverse their length and their breadth, as from one end of the earth to the other. Stop there for a second. Whenever it says 500 years long, that's probably not true. I'm skeptical of that detail. But there's one other paragraph. So it says, "And Moses saw in the seventh heaven the holy Hayot, which support the throne of God, and he beheld the angel Zagzagel, the prince of the Torah and of wisdom, who teaches the Torah in 70 languages to the souls of men, and thereafter they cherish the precepts contained therein as laws revealed by God to Moses on Sinai. From this angel with the horns of glory, Moses himself learnt all the 10 mysteries. Having seen what there is in the 7 heavens, he spoke to God, saying, 'I will not leave the heavens unless thou grantest me a gift.' And God replied, 'I will give thee the Torah, and men shall call it the law of Moses.'" So I'll stop there for a second. That's where it finishes about heavens, okay? So notice what I just read there. That corresponds to what Baruch says. It says, again, it said, Moses was shown, what did it say? Like, you know, the multitude of the innumerable angels, the flaming hosts, orders of the chiefs of the angels, and also this caught me off it says, and the suppression of anger. It talks about like suppression of anger. And remember, in what I read, it says that there was an angel called forged out of chains of black fire and red fire, the angels Af, anger, and Hema, wrath. And so it says the suppression of anger. So I'm wondering if that's connected there. But so you see, there's like a lot of interesting parallels with what I just read and what Baruch says Moses saw. I'm not going to read this unless you guys really insist on me reading it. But what comes next is Moses visits paradise. So he's shown paradise. He's shown hell, or, you know, Gehenna. Yeah, so he's shown that. He's shown Gehenna and he's shown paradise. And that's exactly what Baruch says he saw. It says he was shown paradise, the greatness of paradise, and then it also says he was shown the mouth of Gehenna and the station of vengeance, and it talks about the likeness of future torment. Like, all that stuff, it's corresponding. It has that, and then there's also prophecies later on that I found of the Messiah, where he's shown the Messiah and talks to the Messiah. And was given prophecy of the future. You guys are asking about that. The word is written on our heart. Yeah, the word is written on our heart, but most people are not following what's on their heart because they're stubborn and they don't want to. They have a hard time following the word. So the scriptures were given to us to help us find the truth, because most people are not gonna find it on their own. They're too lazy. They are too like narrow-minded. They're not looking at the bigger picture. But these scriptures are given to us to kind of open our eyes and say, "I'm right here. This is the truth. You're trying to find it on your own. Well, here's the truth, people. I'm giving it to you. Try to use this to help you find the truth." What does Psalms 4:4 say? I don't have it. And it was asked, what about hell? Is there a lot written about that place? There's a section. And I can read that to you guys if you want, or, you know, it depends, because I don't want to bore you guys by reading too much. So, do you guys want me to read a little bit more from what Moses saw according to these things, or just to give you kind of a summary? a summary I can give you guys, or if you want, I can read some more of this summary. Okay, so let's see here. So about hell, here's what we see. A second here. So for instance, at first it says, let me just read it. I'll read a couple sentences. I won't read the whole thing. We'll just to give you a picture of how it introduces it. When Moses was on the point of departure from heaven, a celestial voice announced, "Moses, thou camest hither, and thou didst see the throne of my glory. Now thou shalt see also paradise and hell." So then he starts going, seeing through, and he doesn't want to go in. He's afraid to go into the places of hell, or, you know, torment. And but he's told to go in. He's protected, you know, and he's allowed to enter, and he's shown the different punishments that people have. He's shown different areas of torment, where people here are punished for this reason, people here are punished for this reason. So like some things they're punished for would be, like for, you know, adultery, for turning away from the Torah, and then, you know, murder, let's see here. And then here's one that says, Moses saw the place called Aluka, where sinners were suspended by their feet, their heads downward, and their bodies covered with black worms, each 500 parasangs long. They lamented and cried, "Woe unto us for the punishment of hell. Give us death that we may die." Nasargiel explained, "These are the sinners that swore falsely, profaned the Sabbath in the holy days, despised the sages." That's probably not true. It's by the sages. Called their neighbors by unseemly nicknames, wronged the orphan and the widow, and bore false witness. Therefore hath God delivered them to these worms. And then there's another one near the end. It says, Nasargiel explained, "These are the sinners who ate carrion and forbidden flesh, who lent their money at usury, who wrote the name of God on amulets for Gentiles, who used false weights, who stole money from their fellow Israelites, who ate on the Day of Atonement, who ate forbidden fat and animals and reptiles that are an abomination, and who drank blood." So, you know, it has some of that stuff, and also paradise. He's shown paradise and the different glory things in paradise. He's shown the tree of life, and yeah. So that those are the essentially what he's shown for the prophecies for that. And then, as I said, he was also shown like from what the Messiah said, and so he meets the Messiah in heaven. Like it says, when he he ascends into heaven, and it says he saw a temple in heaven, and it says in this temple he beheld the Messiah. And then a little bit later it says, "Moses now fell upon his face before God, saying, 'Permit me to speak to thy Messiah before I die.' God then said to Moses, 'Come, I shall teach thee my great name, that the flames of the Shekinah consume thee not.' When the Messiah, David's son, and Aaron beheld Moses approach them, they knew that God had taught him the great name, so they went to meet him and saluted him with the greeting, 'Blessed be he that cometh in the name of the Lord.' Moses thereupon said to Messiah, 'God told me that Israel was to erect a temple to him upon earth, and now I see him build his own temple, and that too, in heaven.' The Messiah replied," and then he, you know, the Messiah says stuff to him, and so it preserves a conversation, and there's a prophecy about the exile. And so, but yeah, so that just gives you a taste of this Moses book. So when it says, it's a kind of a long answer to that question of, was Moses, you know, why is it called Moses a prophet? He was a prophet according to these writings. Well, what I first read, the prophecies of paradise, heaven, and hell, that was pre-Exodus. But seeing the Messiah was at the near the very end of his life, in the last year of his life. And so if this extra writing is true, and as we said, Jude confirmed it to us, Jude quotes from this other writing and endorses it, we have to believe that he had many more prophecies that weren't written down. The New Testament says, let me see where it says it in the New Testament. It just, the way it's worded in the New Testament doesn't correspond with our copies very well. So here's what it says. Let me turn to it. This is the Gospel of John. Let's see here. So here's what it says. Okay. It says, "Do not think that I shall accuse you to the Father. There is one who accuses you, Moses, in whom you trust. For if you believed Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote about me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words?" But the problem is, the Jews did believe Moses' writings. The law of Moses, that is, they believed Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. But what about Moses' other writings, which actually talk about the Messiah, which would be as a Jubilees, and this Testament and Assumption of Moses, because in them talks about the Messiah, in the Testament and Assumption. So if you believed Moses, you would believe me, because he wrote about me. He wrote prophecies about me. But if you do not believe his writings, which the Jews don't accept these writings, they don't believe these writings were truly written by him, how will you believe my words? Because you're not even believing what Moses said about me. So that's kind of how I interpret about Moses. So anyways, that's hopefully that answers that question of how Moses was a prophet, in my understanding. So is there any... We've done this for about... not quite 2 hours, but almost 2 hours. Is there any final questions people have that I can try to quickly address? But if not, then we will try to pick this up. You know, if you guys want to come back, if you like what you heard, I want to do this like once a week with people who are interested in studying with me. Because people asked me, like, when are you going to do another study? I was asked this by some people, because I just kind of kept putting it off, and I wasn't really wanting to do it. Just focused on other things, but I think that if people are interested, then I really should be doing this once a week. If people are willing to come once a week, then I'll do this. So those who are interested, come. I can send you the list if you guys are interested of the books I accept. But so any final questions, you could type that right now. Any final questions if you have for me. We have done it for, just so you know, an hour and 40 minutes, about. An hour and 40 minutes, so. I have one, there's at least one other question that someone asked, so I will address this. How often did they fast? Are you talking about the Essenes, or who are you talking about, Melissa, when you say how often did they fast? The apostles. Okay. How often did the apostles fast? Well, first of all, we know the Day of Atonement, according to the law. That's the one day. The Old Testament tells us, Jeremiah tells us four fasts that were supposed to be done by the people. And these are commemorating things about Jerusalem and Israel, and these are four feasts. Jeremiah mentions it, and Zechariah, I think, mentions it. Some of the Old Testament mentions the four fast days. Okay, so there was at least five there. There's, you know, the fast days of unleavened bread, where you fast from leaven. And then the apostles also, there's some extra writings, okay, in as I said, the Ethiopian books, which say, and there's other books too that support this idea, there's many extra fasts that the apostles did. There was ordained, you know how the Pharisees fasted on Monday and Thursday, and in the New Testament, we see the Pharisees bragging about themselves, and they say, we're so righteous because we fast twice a week on Mondays and Thursdays. And the Messiah basically was like, you know what? You think you're so righteous. I'm going to make something. I'm going to make some fast days, but intentionally on other days, just to spite you guys. And these are the true fast days. You know, you want to do two fasts a week? Okay, let's do two fasts a week. But they're going to be my days, not yours. So basically the apostles say in their writings, they say, don't follow the two fast days that the Pharisees do. Follow the two ones that the Messiah told us to do. And those are Wednesdays and Fridays. Or in other words, they are the fourth day of the week and the sixth day of the week. This is what the apostles said. They also said some other fast days that were a little controversial, but there were some other ones. And then there was a, there's also fasting for repentance. When you're caught in a sin and you're being excommunicated for your sin, you're supposed to fast in repentance. For a certain amount of time, you're not allowed to fellowship with the other people. You're banned from entering the church service, participating of it. And you're not allowed to be with the body. You have to separate yourself until you fast and repent from your sin. So there was fasting for that as well. But so there was a lot more fasting days that the apostles did. The Essenes didn't do nearly as many because the Essenes came before the apostles. And so any extra days that the Messiah or the apostles were saying to do, the Essenes didn't do because, as I said, you know, they hadn't come yet, so they weren't doing all that stuff. They were just doing Old Testament stuff. I hope that answers that question. And the Zetzites of those, I believe those are required for those who are his people, and those will be held to accountable to it. So if they break the commandments, they will... if they don't wear tzitzits, they will be punished for that. I believe, however, Gentiles who are, you know, pagans who are not part of the true religion, who don't worship the true God, they're not part of his covenant of salvation. They will not be punished for not wearing tzitzit. The tzitzit will not be, they will not be, because they're not part of his people, he's not going to judge them for that, because those are signs of his people. Okay, and the tzitzit, they're just strings, Sandra. The tzitzit are hanging from your garments as a sign to teach you to keep the commandments. And the females wear those. I believe they did because, you know, the law tells us why we're given those commandments. And the reason for why is to remember the commandments. But here's the thing. Do only men have to remember the commandments? No, of course not. You know, women have to remember it as well. And so, and one thing, there isn't a, in the Ethiopian Bible, it actually says that the story that the Jews teach, that the color, the blue color for your tzitzit, it says the color for your tzitzit, that the blue one, when the Jews tell you that you have to get it from a snail, ignore that story. That story is garbage. That's what the Apostle Peter says in the this extra book of the Ethiopian Bible. He says, ignore that story. That's fake. That's not. That's a myth. So it seems to me that Peter wouldn't have said that unless he thought it was important to talk about that. If tzitzit wasn't required anymore, he probably wouldn't have even mentioned that. So the fact that he stresses to say, the story they tell you about the snail, That's not true. Don't listen. Don't follow that. Implies that we should be following the Tzitzit commandment. All right. And the, yeah, so next week, hopefully, you all will be there. Kay, I hope you will be there as well. And, and covering the head. All right, we'll see you later, Kay. This was recorded as well, so if you any of you wanted to listen to some of it again, it'll be available. And for next week, we'll see you all next week. So I'll answer the question that you guys asked here, but for those who have to go now, you can go. And so Melissa asked about covering the head, and the law seems to imply that there's a covering of the head that's supposed to be required in certain instances, because it says in the book of Numbers that a woman who is accused of adultery and is supposed to go through a special trial where she's drinking water, okay, she's drinking water, to the bitter water, to see if she's guilty or not. It says that she has to remove her covering. Well, for it to say remove the covering implies that the covering is the standard or the norm, right? And so it doesn't say in the law that we have it that they have to wear a covering, but it's implied that women are supposed to wear a covering who are married. Because the removal, the reason, so the woman removed the covering as a indication that the woman is being the covering teaches about that you're under the authority of the man, right? And so because she's being accused for going against his authority, it's not clear that she's following his authority anymore. So they say, okay, take off your covering, because we're not sure if you're being honest and part of your being really under his covering. So take it off for now until we figure this out. So it's like a symbolism there, okay? And when Paul says to cover the hair, he talks about how this is a requirement that we have to do, and for those who don't do it, he says that those are not following what God is saying. So most people who don't agree with the idea fault Paul as making things up, you know. But in the Ethiopian books, it actually has the apostles saying the same thing. So if this is true, many of Paul's teachings are actually agreeing with the apostles' teachings, actually, if these books, extra books, are scripture. So to judge Paul fairly, if these other books are legitimate, we really have to read what these other books are saying, because maybe he's not really being so different in his teachings from the other apostles. Maybe they actually are very similar. So the apostles say in their writings that a woman is to wear a head covering, but when? So the question is when? In my understanding, the times are, it's not all the time, but it's, first of all, when you're in church, or, you know, in a holy place, excuse me, in a holy place, when you're, you know, and then when you are walking in public in, basically when you're in public, okay? When you're in private property, I don't believe you are required for that. Especially amongst your believers, because they're your brother and sister. So, you know, you're supposed to be all fine with each other. But what they say is, when the woman is walking out and she doesn't have her covering, all these pagan men will be observing her, right? You know, and so it's because of these men, especially when she's walking out in public, that she's to cover her hair. And then also when she's in a holy place, it's a symbolism as well. That's my understanding. I don't think it's needed when you're with your family or in a private setting where the people you trust, you know, you're trusting the people there. That's my take on it from the scriptures that I have read. So I think that'll probably be it for today. I hope you all enjoyed this teaching, and I'll try to load the video up for others. And did you guys say you wanted the list? Who of you wanted the list? I can send it to you on Facebook. The list of these books. There's David and Sandra. Listen. Okay. So I'll try to send it to everyone here. Okay. So, all right, that's it. And see you guys next week. Shalom.